Every smart home geek wants to show off their smart home, and I've seen a lot of videos where you're taken around their homes and shown a selection of their favourite gadgets. I'm going to do things a little differently. I'm going to bore you to death with information, so you'll need to watch this video again to see the bits that you've missed. I'm not really going to show you specific gadgets, but I will give you quite a detailed overview of how my whole system hangs together. There's going to be a lot of detail, so let's dive in. Now, generally I have a rule for home automation, and that is I must hide as much of it as possible. Everything in my home should look normal, like it's not necessarily smart wherever possible, and it should be controllable manually too. This doesn't apply for everything because sometimes it's just not possible, but for things like lights, and yes, I've got smart lighting in most rooms, but there is still a light switch on the wall where you'd expect it to be. And the house detects when everyone has gone to bed, powers things off that aren't needed, but it always makes sure that they're back on before they're needed. Nobody must notice what happened, but it was being smart. Now I'm going to put a diagram up on the screen now, but please don't run away as soon as you see it. Everyone draws a diagram to keep track of their home automation systems, don't they? You must all do that too, right? And here it is. Don't panic, it's not as bad as it looks. Well, maybe it is actually. Let me go over what the various components are. The red diamonds are all physical devices. They're the smart home devices that I'm controlling or need to get data from. Just looking across the top, you can see my Zigbee network, which links to things like smart switches and plugs and a few light bulbs. Then we have my Z-Wave network. All of my smart lights run on Z-Wave. I'll go over that in a little bit more detail later on though. But you can see down the side we have Amazon Echo speakers, my Logitech Harmony hub for controlling the TV, Solar Edge inverter for my solar panels, everything. The black arrows show where these devices are communicating. Some of them are talking to these fluffy clouds, which represent internet-based cloud services. For example, my energy devices like the Eddy for heating your hot water or Zappy EV charger, which I don't have, can only be controlled via the cloud. So Eddy talks to the My Energy cloud, and the hub of my automation solution, Home Assistant, talks to the My Energy cloud too. A lot of devices are able to talk directly to Home Assistant locally, which is great. So yes, this large green circle right in the center is Home Assistant. Home Assistant is the beating heart of my smart home. It links all of the various devices together, carries out all of the automations, and is in my mind the best home automation platform around. I've used a number of alternatives over the years. I used domotics for a long time, but I found device support to be a bit lacking and the user interface started to look a bit dated. When the SD card in my Raspberry Pi that ran domotics died, I moved over to SmartThings. Again, this was great to start with, but when they started to lock down the platform and broke the third-party web core automation platform it used, I had to jump ship because it couldn't cope with the complexity of the automations that I required. I'm running Home Assistant on a Raspberry Pi 4. It's in a special Argon 1 case that includes a special slot for an M.2 SSD. I'd strongly advise you to run Home Assistant from an SSD, not a normal SD card, otherwise you may find it wears the SD card out quickly, which can be very frustrating. Plugged into my Pi is a USB hub, and hanging off there are a number of physical USB devices. There's a Conbee 2 stick for Zigbee support, an Aeotec Z-Stick for Z-Wave, a Honeywell HDI80 which connects to my Evo home heating system, and an RFX comm which is used for snooping on and controlling 433 MHz wireless RF devices. Back to the diagram then. This large blue square is my Raspberry Pi. Specifically, it's Home Assistant OS, which is a special operating system you install on the Pi, so as it's dedicated to running Home Assistant. Behind the scenes, it's actually running Docker-style containers, so Home Assistant itself runs in a container. You won't notice any of this, and it doesn't really matter most of the time, but the consequence of that is that you're able to reboot Home Assistant on its own without rebooting the whole Raspberry Pi. Well, why would you want to be able to do that? These blue circles here are Home Assistant add-ons. Home Assistant has an add-on store that you can browse and install things that give you extra functionality. I'm running several add-ons, such as the Mosquito MQTT broker, which lets lots of different smart home components send messages to each other and communicate in a standard language. I also run Zigbee to MQTT and Z-Wave JS add-ons that let me run Zigbee and Z-Wave networks, and they communicate with Home Assistant via the MQTT broker. I also have Give TCP running so as I can communicate locally with my Give Energy battery and PSA car controller that deals with communicating with my Vauxhall car. All of those add-ons run as separate containers in the background, and because they are separated like that, I can reboot them individually without them affecting anything else. Likewise, I can restart Home Assistant after making a configuration change and it won't affect my Z-Wave network at all. Now, to control all of this, you can use the dashboards in Home Assistant, but if you're an iOS user, then it's very convenient to use Apple Home. It's really easy to configure Home Assistant to publish devices to Apple Home, and I have another video on how to do that if you're interested in seeing how that's done. If you want to be able to control Home Assistant devices using Apple Home from outside of your local network though, then you need some sort of Apple Hub device. This can be a permanently connected iPad, a HomePod, or an Apple TV. I have an Apple TV that's permanently connected, and that acts as a relay for Home to the outside world. Now, if I slide down the diagram a bit, there's a blue bubble on its own. That's because it's a container running Docker on my Synology NAS. This is HomeBridge. HomeBridge connects devices that don't support Apple's HomeKit platform to Apple Home, and that includes Ring cameras. Now, I could run HomeBridge as an add-on on my Raspberry Pi, but because we're dealing with video feeds here, I've chosen to run it on my NAS, which has a bit more processing power. Using HomeBridge to publish my Ring cameras to Apple Home means that I can view the cameras using the Home app, or even get a pop-up image while I'm watching TV if someone rings the doorbell. I said I'd come back to Z-Wave, and that's because I wanted to talk to you about this in a bit more detail. When I started building my current smart home, Z-Wave was the most established and widely supported protocol available. Indeed, I still think it's the most robust and reliable part. I've installed small modules in various places, all hardwired into my lighting circuits. In some places I've hidden them in the ceiling, but in other places I've put them inside wall buttresses with a blanking plate over for easy access. If I've used a dimmable module, then I've used normal looking momentary switches, but otherwise I've just kept the existing toggle switches because a lot of my lights are wired with two or three way switches. In many ways, Z-Wave is the superior home automation protocol. It creates a wireless mesh throughout your home on a generally empty frequency. It's low bandwidth, has built-in security, and is low power. But it is basically losing out to Zigbee and probably soon Thread too, because it requires manufacturers to pay a license fee to use it. It's losing the battle despite its technical superiority. It's the Betamax of smart home protocols. Oh, and I also think it's important to keep wiring diagrams of all of your hardwired modules from before and after, just in case you need to rip them out in a hurry. Anyway, that's a whistle-stop tour of how I've built my smart home. I know it probably opens up many more questions than it answers, especially as there are so many components connected to it. I haven't even gone into the actual automations I'm running, but hopefully I've either already covered those in previous videos, or you can let me know in the comments if there's anything you've seen here that you'd like me to cover in more detail. Please give the video a like if you found this useful or interesting, and don't forget to subscribe to my channel to see more from me. Thank you for watching. Goodbye.